Hey, welcome back to another episode of Comedy Pinata, live from Zanie's in Nashville, Tennessee. Super, super excited to introduce one of my best pals.
Yes.
In stand-up, came up with him out of New York City, comedy seller. You've seen him everywhere. He's got a ton of credits. Just had a show on Showtime, is that correct?
Yes. Everything's going to be all white.
Everything's going to be all white. Sherrod Small.
Thank you, Steven.
Yeah. Yay. We're clapping.
Clap, yeah. Taylor, you son of a bitch.
You motherfucker. You racist pieces. Yay. It's my black friend. How you doing, buddy?
I'm good. What's going on?
Well, you were telling me the last time you were here at Zanie's must have been 10 years ago.
10 years ago, at least.
And you were doing a tour with Best Week Ever?
Oh, we did a Best Week tour through here, too, around that same time, yeah.
That was a pretty popular show, Best Week Ever.
It was great.
VH1.
Yeah.
You and Christian Finnegan was a regular,
Finnegan,
right?
Finnegan was on it. Chuck Nice. A bunch of people. The white girl. That kid.
The other one.
The fat one. Yeah, it was a lot of people.
The ginger nobody talked to.
That's right.
Now, how is, obviously, we started off at the, you were past the cellar before I was, obviously.
That's right, Steven. I got it ready for the likes of you. I got past in 99.
99? Yeah, that.
Damn, that's a long time ago.
You might have gotten in just before I did, because I think I was 99.
Yeah.
Explain to people that have never been in the cellar, because the cellar is such an iconic venue, what it was when we first started to what it is today. Because I think people don't even realize, but you've seen the osmosis of it being kind of like this dilapidated frat house that a select few were invited to. And now?
Now it's like, you know, it's four rooms now. But when we first started out, it was just the original room on McDougal Street, 117, below the Olive Tree. And it was, what, 100 seats, 125 seats maybe?
If that, yeah.
If that. And, yeah, we have the jockey for positions. It was it wasn't a whole bunch of spots like it is now.
Yeah.
It was only like 8 or 9 mm-hmm. a night, was it? Or was it more than that? Maybe like 15? It was 2 separate shows then.
Yeah.
9 and 11.
Yeah.
Something not crazy like
you
that.
You go to 2 in the morning.
Yes, and go 2 in the morning. And every night.
We, at least, you had some early spots. I always had the 145 or 130. Me and Lampanelli were always flipping.
Yeah, right. Yes.
It was like Godfrey, Lamp, and myself, the bottom of 3, always.
Right.
Don't take it personally.
Okay, sure. In 6 years?
That was a good SD. But the room was everything, though. We loved that room. We always ended up there after our shows. We always hung out there. We always ate there.
Yep.
So, you know, it's good to see that it grew until, like, you got the Village Underground room now, which is the biggest room.
Yeah.
And then the 2 rooms upstairs and a Fat Black room. I didn't think they both would work at the same time, being across from each other.
Fucking crazy.
It's crazy.
And
it's
like, all the shows are sold out.
All the shows sold out. Pretty much, yeah.
When you go to the cellar, obviously as a comic, you experience many different things, right?
Yeah.
On and off stage. Obviously, we see, you know, Chris Rock or Chappelle come in. You're like, wow, it's still like, even as a comic now, still you're like, wow, that's really awesome.
Right.
One of my favorite experiences was with you.
What?
The greatest fist fight I've ever seen in my life.
Oh, God.
This is the greatest fist fight I've ever seen in my life. To this day, you couldn't script this, and I'm not making any of this
break
up.
Break it down for the break them down.
We, as we normally did, we indulged in the beverages, cocktails. We have a few, nightcap. Sherrod, of course, I think this goes without saying. Right. You enjoy the company of the ladies?
Yes, indeed. Yeah.
So
that's right.
Sherrod's talking to a very, very pretty, attractive white woman.
Now, were we at the cellar or did we go to another bar?
We started off at the cellar.
We started off at the cellar, right.
We started off at the cellar, and Sherrod's one of those guys, too. If he's with a girl, it's like, it doesn't matter. It's like, he's there for the hang. He's there for the good time.
Right.
So I'm just bullshitting, hanging out. I'm thinking, okay, we'll have a good night, guys. He's like, no, come hang with us. So your thing would always be to go to the Upper East Side at the time. And then, for some reason, we went to Hell's Kitchen because I just moved there.
Right.
Let's go explore there. So you bring this girl. We go to Hell's Kitchen. Now, it's probably 3 in the morning.
Yeah.
It's me, you, this really cute girl, and there's 2 white guys on the other side.
Right. At this bar.
Now, they're
hating.
Mad dogging you.
Yeah.
Hating.
Hating big
they
time.
They don't appreciate. You think we're in Dixie, right?
Yeah.
Sherrod. Here's the component I left out.
The chicken wings?
That's right. The cellar is known amongst the comics as having the best wings, right?
Right, right.
So every night, Sherrod would get his wings, and he'd bring them home with him, okay? Now, Sherrod is carrying the wings with him from bar to bar. But we go to this bar,
right?
And we're there. Sherrod puts his wings down. He's still got the wings. And these dudes are looking. And Sherrod, the mood changed within 5 minutes. I'm like, everything okay? He's like, these fuckers, you know, they keep looking or whatever.
They're hating.
So then you say, you know, is there an issue or whatever? You got a problem? He's like, yeah, I got a problem. So Sherrod gets up and goes outside. Next thing I know, the guy goes. Now, Sherrod took the wings with him. Yeah. I've never seen that before in my life.
I don't leave my wings. You know how good those wings are? Comedy selling wings. I can't leave them in a bar.
But you would think you put the drink, you leave the wings, and then but he took the wings with him, okay? So he goes outside. The guy mouths off. Sherrod's standing there holding his own. The guy comes up and just mouthing off to Sherrod. Sherrod just, bink, drops this. I've never seen it. Just like, it was like the on switch is here, and you have to, he hit him right in the jaw. The guy dropped down.
Turned him off.
The guy comes over, his friend, he goes, you can't fucking do that.
Bing.
Bing. He fucking turned the other guy off. Two dudes passed out. The guy passed out on top of his friend. Sherrod's holding his wings. Didn't even move his left hand, not like swinging around, like there's going to be a thing or whatever. There was no shoving. Usually there's shoving
right.
that's entailed. Maybe yeah. That's a white person. I don't know, but I don't
it
know.
Was you just two clean hits.
Bink, bink. And these guys both dropped on top. And I was like, well, I think that'll do it for me, because after you see something like that, it's like you got to go get laid.
Yeah, that was over. The girl, yeah, the girl saw it too, did she?
Oh, she saw the whole thing. Oh, yes,
right. She did see the whole thing.
She saw the whole thing. And I saw her like, holy shit. There were two girls watching.
Right.
Me and her. Oh, my God. What? I'll fucking know you. Fucking amazing. I've never seen anything like it.
Yeah, that was a crazy night. We were different people back then. We were different people. I got a kid now.
That's right. Yeah.
I'm a father. I can't be knocking niggas out in the street. Can't do it no more, T.
What is one of your, just reflexively, it doesn't have to be top, whatever, just a great recollection of your early years at the Cellar? What's something that just brings to
so
mind?
So many, though.
I ran into Keith Robinson last week, and I saw him come in, and he obviously had a stroke recently.
Right.
And walked in, and
he's
he sat down.
He's racking up some strokes, ain't he? Greedy. How many strokes are you going to have? Save some strokes for us, Keith. Looking forward to a stroke in a couple years.
But he comes walking in, and he's looking at me, smiling. I go, oh, I'm just waiting for you to shit on me, Keith, to make me feel at home, you know?
Yeah.
And he's like, I'm not going to shit on you. I knew he was bubbling. But
I remember one time when I had to break up a fight between Greg Rogel? And Kevin Brennan.
Come on.
And they knocked Esty on the ground.
No.
Yes.
What? Yes. Wait, what? How did that even start?
Nobody remembers that, but it was downstairs at the room. You know that little hallway we always wait mm-hmm. where they light everybody to go in? I mean, where they light you to come off stage. So it's right in that little nook. Mm-hmm. And Rogel and Rogel.
I can see Kevin pushing somebody's buttons. So Kevin had to be the offender here,
I
right?
think so.
Because Rogel's such a nice, laid-back dude. He's so easygoing.
No, Rogel, when he gets angry, he's angry.
Yeah, but I mean, you'd have
oh, but
to
you
push
have to
him
really push
to
him.
Get
right.
him
right.
to get to,
right.
you know, I've never seen Rogel angry.
Right, he was angry. He was angry, and then I think Kevin was on stage, mm-hmm. and then he was waiting in the hallway for Kevin to come off. I think I might have been hosting or something, or just on the show. I don't remember. But I remember it was a weekend, and I remember Esty was down there, because remember she's always be down in that little nook.
Just watching. Oh, I'm just watching. Great. There goes my spots next week.
That's a good
Better not fucking bomb.
Oh, my God. So he's on stage, and then Kevin, I don't know, maybe they had a beef before. They had beef before he got on stage, and it was like arguing. Greg was just in the hallway fuming. Right. I'm like, this is about to kick off. I think this is going to kick off.
Yeah.
Kevin comes out, says something slick to him in the hallway. Greg grabs him. And this was obviously where Essie right there. Greg grabs him, like scratches him. Like grabbing his neck, like went for a shirt, but grabbed with skin.
Oh, shit.
And had him against the wall. Essie get knocked out the way, pushing his wall for. I'm like, oh, shit. I'll jump in there, break these, pull this nigga off of Kevin. Yeah. Help Essie up.
Right.
And, but they so white, they ain't even miss spots. Nah, it didn't even affect their spots the next week.
And I got to say, I'm very happy because we have our first official N-word of the Comedy Pinata podcast. So
nobody ever said it?
Nobody ever said it.
So you had no
it,
blacks on here, in other words.
We had Mike James on.
I said black.
But describe to people, because I think even when you say you used to, there were mainstays of hosting. I would host a lot.
Yeah.
Artie hosted a lot. Yeah. And you hosted a lot.
Well, Artie didn't host a lot at first. Remember, they wouldn't let Artie host. And I used to be like, why don't you let Artie host? He got mad energy. They were like this. Nope. They didn't let Artie host until the other rooms open.
We save him for after midnight.
Artie would come in there, like, you know, 12:30.
Yeah.
He always have the last spot every night.
Yeah.
And I used to be like, let him host. Yeah. They used to be absolutely not.
Yeah, you would think. Yeah, I guess because
the last best hosts now.
Of course he is, yeah. But describe to somebody what it's like to host, because you just tell them the hours.
Oh, yeah, we used to work from 9 to at least 2:30, 3 o'clock, 9 p.m.
And that's if Dave or Chris didn't come in.
That's if a big name didn't come in.
Yeah.
And we had to pay the comics.
That's right.
Remember that nonsense?
Yeah. Oh, my God, yeah.
Oh, I got rid of that real fast, because I used to fuck the money up. I'm like, this ain't what I'm here for. I'm trying to write jokes.
Yeah, they give you a stack of cash, and then the thing, and then have everybody sign it. Yeah.
Oh, I was like, this should not be in the hands of a comedian.
Yeah.
And I used to
5 hours.
Yeah, 5 hours.
5 hours. At least 5 hours.
Yes.
Keeping the energy up.
Yep.
All fucking night.
Yep. And I used to buy weed with their money sometimes. Because I'm like, all that money's in my pocket. I don't know what's your money and my money. I'm a comic. Let the managers do that. And then they switch it to the managers.
They got it to the manager.
Well, they bought me a lot of good weed, boy. Yeah. I'm like, it's 80 short. I ain't paying it. It ain't coming out of my pocket.
But that's amazing. But I think when you host those shows, it's kind of like, it's almost like going to college.
Yeah.
You learn so much education.
No question
from
about
that.
It. You used to have Mark Maron and Patrice and, you know, Jim Norton, and all these guys were everyday guys. Mm-hmm. These guys were in the everyday. So you got to be around that kind of energy with Keith and, you know, everybody was in there. So it was the best time in the world.
I think that club single-handedly is like going to college.
Yeah.
You get your education because you're not just doing spots. You're being introduced to following iconic comics, being around them. Seeing how they interact, you're seeing how Collin Quinn, for example, treats everybody.
Yeah.
It's like, oh, that's how you want to treat people.
Yeah.
And you're seeing the turnover material, especially back in the day with like Geraldo.
Yes.
The honesty of Patrice.
Dude.
The honesty of Norton.
I mean, and this is like, that's when it was only about 12 spots a night.
That's it, yeah.
So, and you competing against those dudes. Mm-hmm. It wasn't easy getting spots in there.
No.
But we got spots.
It wasn't easy to do well in that room
either.
Because there were nights on Tuesday you'd have 40 people there, and you're following Patrice, Geraldo, Norton, and then it's like
Mark Maron.
Now we're shifting in the late shift, and it's like the audience could tell there's a difference because there was the young guard of us.
Right.
Now we're kind of the vets now, and there's a bunch of young guards coming in, which is really fun to see, and it's inspiring. And I mean, I know he's not that much younger, but I saw Jermaine Fowler.
Oh yeah,
up there, and his set. It's rare I like to sit and watch, but I was like, you know, we worked together on a film, and I was like, I got to see Jermaine. I love him.
Right.
A to Z, fucking crushed it.
Crushed it.
Absolutely crushed it. And it was like, that's so inspiring to me to see somebody be that creative with his material and so honest. And he was talking about his home life and his brother. I was just like, that's fucking amazing.
Yeah.
I really enjoyed watching him.
Yeah, Jermaine's great. Jermaine's
the
great.
The nicest guy off stage.
Jermaine's great. Yeah, it's Jermaine, that little bastard. I love him.
All right. Let's get into this. Let's see who, again, I don't know who these are in here, so we're just going to see who number one is, and it's going to be, we were just talking about
Collin
Quinn. What are your initial thoughts on Collin Quinn?
I've known Collin since I was 9 years old.
Yeah.
He used to come to the block and give me and Tony Rock, my cousin Tona, like $2 each, and we were like, let's go get heroes.
Right. You're probably telling that this is
truth.
Honest, right?
It's honest truth, yeah. Collin was the only white dude who came to our house, other than a mailman.
Right. But Collin was
bedside.
Coming over because...
He lived in Brooklyn. And Collin and Chris Rock were, you know, knocking it out at the comic strip around that time. Mm-hmm. So, Collin was like a superhero to us. Collin and, like, Richie Tinkin, like, Lucian.
Oh, yeah.
All those people were superheroes to me in town.
So, Richie owned the comic strip live on the Upper East Side.
Right.
And was Eddie Murphy's manager.
Yes. And he's in Beverly Hills Cop when he was like, that was the house that Eddie was standing in there. And he's like, ooh, this black guy in my house. That was Richie at the end
right.
of the movie.
Yeah. And one of the greatest hair.
Oh, like, yeah.
It's just an amazing set of hair. Collin Quinn, I think, is the, like, at least for me back in the day, he was the anchor of the Comedy Cellar. You had all these talented comics, but he was the most established Weekend Update on SNL, the most prolific, and by the way, the kindest.
Yes, no question.
The kindest.
One of the best human beings I've ever met in my life.
He treats the waitstaff as well as he treats an A-list comic that comes and sits at the table.
Yes.
So let's listen to a little
Collin Quinn.
Collin Quinn here.
The place, your class was your class for life. Your name imprisoned you. Some guy in another country, I'd like to be a lawyer. What's your name? Williamson. Williamson, right? You're Williamson? The cobbler. Yeah, here's my shoe, you stupid ass. Get over there. Fix my shoe. The ball's on him. What do you want? I want to be a doctor. What's your name? Johnson. Yeah, blacksmith John. Right? Here's my fucking horse's shoe, you idiot. Over here, your name doesn't... That's why the Kardashians is the perfect American story. They're the story of America going west and fulfilling their dream. First of all, you have to understand something. Kardashians, their name did not hold them back. Name got out there in the 90s, the father, Robert Kardashian, OJ's lawyer. That's the first time anyone heard the name Kardashian. Then he was the cover-up guy in the OJ case. He hid the murder weapon for OJ. People forget. He's the guy that went to the house, left, and suddenly... So he dies. A few years later, daughter grows up, makes a sex tape. So most any other culture in the history of the world would be like, mother would call the family together, we've had a couple of dishonorable incidences. Our name is being sullied. We need to restore our crest, our name. What we do is we lay low for a couple of generations. And, you know, hopefully someday. Kris Jenner is American. She understands. She said, calls the family together. Guys, we had a murder. We had a cover up. We had a sex tape. This is our shot. You
understand? So funny.
Oh, my God. And that's just that's just a raw setup. I would have loved to have seen more of that.
Collin's just the best.
To go into it, but...
And back when he was coming out, like, coming to Brooklyn, hanging with Chrissy, he started off bartending at the comic strip.
Oh, he did?
He was a bartender at the comic strip, and then he got into the comedy.
Bruce Willis was a bartender at the comic strip as well.
I heard a story about that.
That was his last gig before he got moonlighting.
Wow.
So I'd always heard that. And then Idris...
What?
Idris... Elba? Was the doorman at Caroline's. Do you remember that?
Oh, I do remember that. Yes, yes, he was the door guy. That's when he was still DJing.
It's amazing that sometimes the people that are peripherally around comedy ascend even more
bigger.
than the comics themselves.
Yes. But yeah, Collin used to, that's back when Collin was drinking, and Richie was drinking back then too. Mm-hmm. I remember Chris used to come home in Richie's car because he would drop Richie home. That's how, because they wouldn't let him drink and drive.
Wow.
And he used to come home and we'd just be staring at it like, that's Richie's car. And people on the block be like, what are y'all whispering? What are y'all doing?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Nobody else cared about comedy like me and Tone and Chris. Yeah, of course.
Right.
Chrissy.
I mean, you guys were so exposed to it at such an early age, too.
Yeah.
And then I always knew you at the Cellar, but what were you doing prior to the Cellar? Were you running around doing city spots?
I got past the strip. First.
That was your first one, okay.
Yeah, and Boston. Boston was the first place I ever got paid. Gina Savage was the first person in comedy to pay me and Tony any money.
Wow.
That first $5 we ever got from jokes came from Gina Savage. I always remind her of that, too. She's at the Cellar now.
Yeah, she's over there now, yeah.
And I was like, she paid us the first money at Boston Comedy Club. And I was like, oh, my money?
Yeah.
For that?
Yeah.
This is my home.
That's it?
Yeah.
And how old were you at that time when you first got paid?
20-something.
Yeah, early
20s. Yeah, early 20s.
So those of you who don't know, Boston Comedy Club was owned by Barry Katz, who at the time was one of the biggest comedy managers in the business.
Yeah, he had Chappelle and Dane Cook and
half the roster of SNL at the time.
Yeah,
Tracy, Wanda Sykes,
yep.
Gaffigan. I mean, you name it. Any New York comic at that time, Barry Katz had them signed, and he opened his own comedy club called the Boston Comedy Club because he's from Boston, and it was literally two blocks away from the Cellar.
Right.
And it fucking sucked.
You know, but I love that room, though.
It sucked when the rooms, they never had a crowd there.
But when they did have a crowd, Saturday and Sundays, they had, no, it was Friday and Saturdays, they used to get more people in there.
I'm saying the only reason I say it sucked is because it was like you'd go from the cellar
right.
and think, oh, my God, HBO should be calling me any minute. Right. And then you go to this, then you go to the boss and you're like,
back
oh,
to life,
back to reality. Oh, my God. It was
but when that place was
awful.
Bumping, it was bumping, though.
It was great. But
Lewis Schaefer just came to town like 2 weeks ago.
One of the best
ago.
MCs yeah. ever. Gay, him and Mark gay? Cohen. Carl Cohen was one of my favorite MCs.
Oh, yeah, Mark. Yeah, yeah. He still is. You know he works at the cellar in Vegas.
Every
I went
time
to that dummy's
like,
house.
Can I talk to you for a second? It's just like, it's the dumbest joke, but he told me this great joke. We were hanging out. He's like,
I love him.
He was like, we were talking about having our daughters, right? And he's like, yeah, my daughter's at that age now where she doesn't really want to hang out with me, whatever. But I was like, look, let me take you out, like a daddy daughter kind of dinner date. So, so they go out, and he says, he's pulling in the driveway because she's staying with the mom, right?
Right.
And he looks over at her and he goes, hey, I just want to tell you, I had a really great time tonight. She's like, yeah. He's like, I'd like to do this again. Can I call you? She's like, Dad, will you leave me the fuck alone? It's like, it's such a fucking hilarious thing to say to your daughter.
It's so, oh, Coco.
But it's so him. It's
he's a madman. I love it. I went to his house in Vegas. He got a new house. This was maybe like right before the pandemic.
Yeah.
Right before the pandemic. And I went by his new house, and we got in the pool and shit.
That's great.
He's a cool dude, man.
Great guy. He had a show back in the day on Comedy Central, Make You Laugh, right?
Was it Make You Laugh? No, it was, what was it?
Make You Laugh. He brought all these people out,
it was
and you
make
had to
laugh.
Make somebody laugh in a minute.
But didn't he have another show he hosted, too, like some Nickelodeon thing or something?
He had one after that, yeah. But that was the one where Comedy Central first came on the air.
Right.
And Mark was one of the first
right,
guys to actually have a
right,
show.
That's right.
And not just do stand-up. And
that's
I always
right.
revered Mark for that. But Collin was co-host of Remote Control back in the day.
And it was huge.
That was a big show.
Huge.
Collin, I don't know. Collin, I love his output of work. And yeah. even like the theme of like the history of the United States of America. Like, he's the only comic I know that had an hour special on CNN.
Yeah.
That's fucking yeah. crazy. But that's yeah. how... deep and how
he's the smartest dude and the funniest dude, man.
Yeah,
like I got a Collin something. He's just one of the funniest guys that I know. Just a smart, smart dude.
And look, Kevin Hart's quick, Norton's quick.
Yeah,
I think Collin still is the quickest draw of everybody because there comes yeah. like a seniority along with his delivery.
Right.
Like, you know, he's seen everything. He's just, yeah, and he's the quickest. I don't know. I think you can tell we both love Collin Quinn. Collin's one of my favorite human beings, and still to this day when I see him, I still feel like a 22-year-old.
Me too. I love him.
Looking up at this guy like, wow, I can't believe, like, you know me.
Love him. Yeah. I remember when he'd come to the house and be like, this is unbelievable that he's here.
Yeah.
And then he'd give us a dollar and we'd go get a sandwich.
The nicest. All right. It's Collin Quinn. Here we go, number two. Let's see who
he's
we
a white
got.
Boy from Brooklyn. That's why I love him.
Oh,
Rich.
Oh, right, another seller, regular. Rich Ross, what do you think when you hear Rich Ross?
He's a madman. I love
Ross. As soon as I pull this out, I remember doing a shitty one-nighter in Jersey, and a woman took a Heinz ketchup bottle and threw it at him. And he was like, what the fuck? You throw a fucking ketchup bottle at me? And there was the initial anger.
Right.
And then he just fucking turned it around on her. And just,
ripped apart.
Oh, my God. It was so fucking
crazy. Wait, a glass bottle?
Glass bottle, yeah. He was like being so offensive.
Right, right.
Which I think is so goddamn funny that she was like, fuck this, I had enough, and threw it at him. And he was, of course, furious, but then he just fucking unpacked on her, and it was great.
Good. But Rich is great. I just saw him I see him all the time, you know, because he plays the stand and the cellar and stuff still. And he's just an old man now.
He's an old man, but he hasn't lost his edge.
Oh, no, on stage he's still a monster. A monster.
I mean, you want to talk about somebody that can just off the cuff.
Yes.
Kind of like, he reminds me of one of those Catskill comics
yeah.
where he's so loaded with a Rolodex of one-liners and great jokes.
Yes.
Almost like vaudevillian in the Catskills, in the modern day, but can make it very modern.
Yes.
And will
never
shit.
Never dated. Don't feel dated
no,
at
no,
all.
No.
Never.
And he'll shit on you.
Yeah.
Relentlessly, but it's so creative and fun.
Yeah.
When I was younger, there were times where it was just like, after 5 years of this shit, I can't take it. I was so pissed one time. I was so, because it was just like every day, Lego head hair, AIDS beard, you know, Asian Elvis, like all this shit. I was just like, I can't take it anymore. So it was one time, Voss was going And I don't, I didn't
it
have
it. Used to get really heavy and hard when the Patrice and Voss
oh,
and
they
Norton
cut
and
deep,
all,
yeah.
Oh, it was on.
But there was one time I pulled the chair out from under Voss as he was going to sit at the table because I didn't have that skill like they did. And Voss got right up and he went like this. And I just stood there. I was like, what did I do? Why would I do that? Like, I do appreciate him. But it's like, would I ever fight Voss? It's like, no. Like, I really like him. And I felt bad after that. And I was
right.
Like, hey, man, I'm sorry. I just, you guys just keep shitting on me.
Oh, my God. They broke Steve. Oh, my God. You can't pull a chair from on the old man, you son of a bitch.
I know. Well, look, he was probably in his 30s at the time.
He was in his 60s then, Steve. Talking about.
Right now, I can't golf tomorrow.
All he likes now is golf and fucking like
gardening,
yard work.
Yeah.
He's such a.
Him and Bonnie McFarlane together. They are
love them both.
So fucking funny.
Oh, my God.
And she is just as funny as he is, and she can fucking give it right back, which
I
love.
I'm telling you. Yeah, I was just with Bonnie this weekend at the stand, too, and she was just killing it. Bonnie kills it.
She has an Emmy.
Yeah.
That's fucking unbelievable.
That sneaky bitch. That sneaky Canadian bitch coming down here, taking our awards.
And she still looks as great today as she did. You know, I hate to be like that guy, but I mean, she looks fantastic. Every time I see her, I'm like, do you age at all? Like, you look fantastic.
Yeah, yeah.
Same with like Rachel Feinstein.
Oh, Rach. You know me and Rachel were roommates for 8 years.
Yeah. But Rachel, I saw her. I was just like, "What are you? Are you drinking puppy blood? Like, you look fantastic."
Yeah, Bridges looks great.
All right, let's watch.
She started out real young too. That son of a
Rachel?
Bitch. Yeah.
Yeah. All right, here we go.
Voss, here we go.
So I'm talking to this guy in the audience. I go, "What do you do?" And he said, "I was on stage earlier. I was up there earlier doing comedy." I go, "Really? You're going to be a comic?" I go, "How old are you?" He said, "I'm 53." I go, "You're starting comedy at 53?" He said, "No, it's on my bucket list." Right? This is his bucket list. This is my life. His bucket list. All right? I've always wanted to fly a plane, but I've never walked into the cockpit and said, "Hey, can I take it around the block a couple times?" Right? So I got a little pissed off, so I started trashing him. Not that bad, but really bad. I'm like trashing this guy. And then out of nowhere, he says, "Well, I don't have health insurance, and I have a brain tumor." Yeah, he used the old fucking brain tumor card. So now the audience hates me because I just trashed this guy for 10 fucking minutes. Right? And I'm like, how am I going to get the crowd back? I'm like, it was so early in the show. I'm going, they hate, like, right now how you're staring at me waiting for the punchline. Pretend there's all hatred in your eyes. They hated me. So out of nowhere, some guy in the audience raises his hand and yells over to that guy and says, "Look, I don't care if you have health insurance. Come to my office this week. We'll take some x-rays and we'll see what we can do." I was like, "Oh, thank God," right? So I look over at the guy and go, "Are you a brain surgeon?" He said, "No, I'm an orthopedic, but brain surgery's on my bucket list."
Bravo.
Oh, that's fucking great.
Bravo.
Fucking great.
Those Love dumb it. Tattoos on his old arms. Look at this stupid tattoo. It's just like years of paint.
His old arms.
Like he was just painting ceilings. It's just dripped on his dumb arms. Those old fucking...
it does make me kind of like nostalgic of back in the day when you would just walk in, they would shit on each other, and then shit on you.
Yeah.
And you felt like, oh, I'm part of the club.
Part of the club. You ain't listen, if they didn't shit on you... They knew you couldn't take it and you wasn't one of them.
Yeah.
It was some comics that they never used to shit on down there.
Yeah.
And I'd be like, why y'all don't shit on? As soon as I'm walking here, y'all attacking me?
Yeah.
They'd be like, that nigga can't take it. You can't say it to him because he'll crumble and take it personal.
Yeah.
That's what Keith used to tell me.
Oh, yeah.
About certain people.
I remember Patrice made a girl cry.
Oh, he made, yeah.
Do you remember?
Oh, who?
I think it was Jessica Delfino?
I think you
she
might be right.
She got up and cried, and Metzger was dating her at the time.
Right. So he was fully aroused when she started crying. That's the only way Metzger could get aroused around her. Can somebody make this bitch cry so I can get a boner?
But I remember it was the only time I saw like some of the comics like go back to Patrice like, man, you should probably apologize for that. And Patrice just doubled down. He
good.
Never did.
He shouldn't apologize for it. Yeah. At the table?
Yeah.
That's like apologizing to somebody on Tough Crowd.
Oh, my God. That show. That
remember
was
when
the
Patrice
best.
Made Ralphie cry?
No. What?
You don't know that story?
No.
First of all, that was my first writing job I ever had in my life. Collin Quinn gave me on Tough Crowd. But Patrice made Ralphie May cry on a show.
Wow.
Because they both fat boys. They was both big boys. But then they were sitting up there, and Patrice was like, I'm big, but what's that hanging in front of Ralphie's? And that guy, wow. When you say a cold breeze came through that studio, man.
Oh, my God.
It now. Shook everybody, and then the camera zoomed on it. Oh, no. Yes, they did.
No.
Like, what's that? He's like, Patrice, like, I'm big too, man. But what's that extra
hump
of meat that's coming? And Ralphie started bawling.
No.
It was,
really?
Yes.
How did Patrice get out of it? Was it just like, that's it, fuck it? Or did
Patrice,
he...
like, I ain't mean to pray. Well, they cut down, they stopped the shooting.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
Yes, you they never said them go like this, cut the tape.
Oh,
on Tough Crowd.
Wow.
Cause somebody's crying.
Yeah.
Tears, real tears, bawling.
Oh, man.
It wasn't a joke.
That.
And Patrice was like, how you cry?
Did he eventually pull him aside or anything?
Yeah, they talked. But Ralphie was pissed after that.
Well, you talked about...
I never saw a comic...
But Ralphie's cut from that same cloth.
He
Ralphie
is.
Would double down too.
Yes.
So I think he would respect what Patrice was saying or doing just off the cuff, being like, oh shit, now I'm caught in a hole.
Right.
How am I going to get out of this?
Right.
One? Yeah.
It just proves that Patrice was that dude.
Oh, but yeah.
And to that he can do it to a dude who was a dude too like that?
That's right, yeah.
It's like, this is a dude showing the dude who do the dude. I'll make you cry on TV with words.
Yeah. I mean, nobody better than Patrice.
What's that thing hanging down?
Oh, fuck.
When he said it, I had papers in my hand. I was like this. It was, I think Geraldo was there. Oh. Keith might have been. I think Keith was there. I think little Kev might have been there. Kevin Hart.
Yeah.
It was a lot of us there. And it was heavy. The crying, I never saw it. It was crazy.
Oh, my God. That's fucking awful.
And but it was like, Ralphie's thing, he came back and fucking crushed the show. But it was,
a pro, yeah.
It was a tough circle.
At the moment.
But that was like the table. The table could get like that.
Oh, the table. Nightly.
Yeah,
nightly. You'd see somebody get up like, fuck this shit. I can't do this anymore. Bobby Kelly. Man, fuck you guys. Fucking, you know. Yeah, but that was...
And definitely if you had, like, a girl there who you, like, dating or wasn't a comic and she sat at the table and then tried to interject.
Yeah.
So I'm like,
nobody
you shouldn't be saying things.
Nobody
it was like, oh,
shit.
You are. Oh, they would get ripped apart.
That's when the placard would come up. only comedy solid comedian.
I remember, he made Lynn Coplitz cry, too, Patrice did. Remember that? He made Lynn Coplitz cry at the table.
Yeah.
And she stormed out. The next day, she brought him a plate of food. I was like, bitch, I'm going to make you cry. I was like, so you brought him a plate? Wrap? I made it special for you, Patrice. I was like, oh, snap.
Yeah, but he was a truth seeker. He spoke his truth undeniably.
Yep. It was never malicious, I don't think. It was always just honest.
It was brutally honest.
Brutal, yeah. But why do we only say brutal when it comes to honesty? Nobody says a brutal lie.
Because he went to...
But you don't say a brutal lie. It's just a lie.
That's true.
Why is honesty got to be brutal? Well, honesty always got to be brutal because you're telling the truth.
All right, here we go. Number three. Here we go. Oh.
Never heard of him.
Chris Rock.
Here we go.
Now you have
you're gonna murder this.
Strong ties to Chris.
Yes, the family.
Yeah.
Tone, me, Chrissy, Jordan, Andre, Kenny, Brian, Shabazz, rest in peace.
It's almost like, I don't want to be disrespectful, but like, the Rock family seems to be like the Nordstrom's compared to the Target that is like the weigh-ins.
I knew he was going to bring that up.
No,
the weigh-ins are great. No.
I like Damon Wayans Jr. I heard, but in terms of like Like, I heard Damon Wayans Jr., or Damon Wayans back in the day,
right,
was one of the greatest comics that never got his due.
Right.
Back in the day.
Remember he got thrown off of SNL and all that, right?
I had heard that, yeah.
Because he made that character gay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I think when you talk about the pedigree, like, of what Chris has done, the ascension, and hearing where he was before Bring the Pain.
Yeah.
And, like, everything, it's not just the special. It's everything that went into making that special and defining, yeah.
He got fired from SNL, too. He got fired from SNL, then had to hit the road and had to make it himself.
Yeah.
Chrissy hit the road after leaving SNL. And then because he was on Living Color, and mm-hmm. remember, Living Color got canceled right away.
Right.
That first season he was on it. Mm-hmm. And when he came from SNL. So he had to hit the road and just do Bigger and Blacker.
Yeah.
So he had to build it. So we saw him every night just going through papers, ribbon, going on stage, coming back, yeah. exhausted. And but it all worked out for him because he took everything that he was doing and put it in that special. Mm-hmm. And then he took everything that was saying they were saying no to on SNL, all his skits. Mm-hmm. And put it on Chris Rock's show.
That's right.
And
yeah.
won Emmys over SNL for yeah. like 3-4 years in a row.
That's right. Yeah.
With the same skits. We used to read the skits like this. Why they ain't put this on?
Sure.
He's like, Lauren got a different vision.
Yeah, but you could also get away with those things on HBO.
I agree.
You couldn't do on a broadcast television. But he was the precursor for sure to Chappelle.
Yeah.
And I thought it was so cool to see that picture posted online where Kev and Chappelle
with the goat.
Came. And who's holding the leash?
Oh, yeah. Chrissy,
and
yeah.
To me, like when I started The Cellar, of course, you revere everybody. You're looking up to Collin. You're looking up to Norton. You're looking up to, you know, Geraldo and Patrice. And like, boy, if I could be as authentic as those guys.
Right.
Not only with my own voice, but as intelligent as them. And then Chris comes in.
Gold
and
standard.
The special drops. And I was like, oh, that's what we could do? Like, that's capable within this industry to like go to like, you know, it was like seeing a black belt then seeing like a ninja.
Right,
you know,
right.
Me, it was like holy shit, and
everybody else was moving in slow motion compared
to
what
never,
he was doing.
I'll never be as good as Chris Rock ever. I'll never be as good as Chappelle ever because in talking to Dave, I understand what he's doing to define his voice, going to museums, you know, putting himself in philosophical situations and breaking those things down and getting it. Like, I just don't, that's not me. I'll never be that person. So I just have a different mentality, but I still like aspire to be as good as those guys, knowing I'll never, but I'd love to think that I could.
But I think as long as we get as much as we can with what we got out, mm-hmm. then you're doing that. It's like you never know your limit. Nobody has limitations. You never know how far it's going to be. So even Chrissy and Dave, they all had doubts. The same doubts. They have doubts now. I just spoke to Chrissy yesterday.
Yeah.
And, you know, he's doing the big tour, him and Kev and all.
Sure.
But he's still working things out.
Yeah, I think that's what makes the greatest.
Yeah.
Because they go through that, and through that doubt, they come out swinging massively and land some fucking knockout blows. But to me, it's just like there's such a creativity that goes into the matriculation of putting something together that even I wouldn't even think about.
Yeah.
It's like that's not even on my radar.
Yeah.
And even if you gave me the subject matter and said, study this, I still don't think I would come up with that.
Because it's his perspective on it. It's like so many times me and Tone saw Chrissy like, change a premise or we'll give him something and then he'll tweak it and be like, God damn, this motherfucker turned it into a different thing.
Yeah.
It's unreal to see. It's like a paintbrush.
Yeah. Look, I mean, we all have our Mount Rushmore, right?
Right.
But I think, you know, you go from vaudeville, you go to Catskills, you go to even the entertainers in Vegas that were catering to a new type of entertainment. There's so many great performers along the way.
Yeah.
Like Bob Hope, should he be on a Mount Rushmore? You know, there's all these people you forget about, and I've tried to study
right.
as much as
George
I can.
George Burns.
Yes.
It's like there's a lot of people who was here doing this before us, was a part of what we do.
Sure, but what we do, I think it starts with Pryor. He fucking flipped the switch
right.
that took it to another degree. Even like people like, oh, Lenny Bruce. It's like,
what about Cosby,
Buddy
though?
Hackett was doing
Don't sleep on Cosby.
Those
early albums, man. Everybody.
For sure.
Everybody studied those. From Jerry Seinfeld to Chris Rock and everybody in between.
But for me, Pryor is Washington because he went so personal and speaking things you would never.
Who?
Richard Pryor.
Oh, Pryor, yeah.
But I like Chris Rock is my second.
I just, and then I go Carlin. Yeah, Carlin and Chrissy, I think it's more like that Hicks, that Bill Hicks type of, like right to your face and points and real stuff and, you know, opinions right there in your face and with no apologies.
Yeah.
And then their particular perspectives on it, that's what makes it so, you know, fingerprinty, is one of a kind.
And I love everything about, I love his cadence, I love his delivery, I love the tone, but just the mind, the mental capacity to come up with those things. And I think we're really in a golden age right now because you're seeing comics touring arenas, theaters, but we're all being inspired by, I think, two of the greatest that are working right now, and Dave and Chris.
I agree.
I think you see these guys, and even when Dave releases the thing that's not a special, but like that 20-minute.
Oh, yeah.
It was just like, that's why that's great, right?
Right.
Because the deep thinking that goes on here, exploring this subject matter, and then lacing it with jokes is here. But you're seeing the wood shop here, right? You're seeing the guy at the sawmill, the work that goes into creating the foundation of the joke.
Yes.
And the mindset. I don't know.
That's why New York clubs, that's why the clubs is so important, because it's the gym, it's the workout room, it's everything. It's like the PSATs.
Yeah.
Everything goes into those rooms. If you like stand up or like, you know, live performance, comedy, so going in there, we used to lose ourselves in there. I used to go in there at 9 o'clock, even if I was my spot be late, I'd go in there to sit and watch all of it. Even upstairs, it's like that camaraderie and all that is all part of stand up.
Yeah.
If you just got in there and did your spot and left, you wouldn't be a good comic. You wouldn't be the same comic.
Some of the best jokes are from comics that aren't even doing it anymore.
Right.
I remember this one guy who was always at Gotham. He was so great. He was so nice, and he always had development deals. And he was always going to L.A. I haven't seen him in years. I forget his name. But one of my favorite bits is about a guy taking off with a girl, and you catch up with him the next day. And all the guys he hung out with was, how'd it go last night with Kelly? Oh, Kelly, yeah. You know, Kelly and I, we went to dinner, went to the theater, had a great time. And, you know, next thing you know, right?
Yeah.
Fucking bang, right? And he was like, I always want to be the next thing you know guy. I'm the needless to say guy, you know?
That's funny.
How'd it go with Kristen? Kristen, we went out to dinner, and then needless to say, she got a little tummy ache and wanted to go home. Just like, that bit has been in my head for years. And I love it. It's one of my favorite jokes.
Do you think, like, the way you write, you sometimes try to chase that same experience in a joke? Because when I hear something that I like, I go, okay, maybe I can make a version of that or flip that onto something else. Like,
yeah,
that mindset.
It's definitely inspiring.
Right.
You know, it's all analogy, right? Right. You're just analogizing things. I think
that's why Chrissy's so great, because he's one of the best analogists.
Him and, I'll tell you, Michael Che.
And Che. Yep.
I watched Che on Update.
Yes.
And all of his jokes are analogous.
Yes.
It's analogous to this, and he's setting it in layman's terms. It's like, him and Jost, I love them on Update because
I love
the camaraderie. I love them two together, but I love Che's delivery. I love his style.
Yes. Because it's kind of like a hit and fist. He's hiding hits.
Yeah,
he's hiding a right cross in here because you don't know where it's coming from with him. That's why I like the surprise. It's like, that's what I try to, you know, that's what I do in my comedy. That's what you do. We try to give some kind of surprise that you don't know, see what's coming. That's what stand-up is.
Yeah, well, I pride myself because I've spent the last few years working on the muscle that is crowd work, right?
Right.
You've always been fucking fantastic at it, and you're...
Thank you, Stephen.
I remember the last time, this was like two trips ago, I was in New York. I came in, I was wearing a suit, I had a polka dot shirt, and you spent 8 minutes shitting on my shirt. Your fucking shirt's polka, it's giving me a headache, I can't even stare at it. You gotta fucking burn that. I mean, it just like, but you had these really clever things that you were saying too. I was like, man, it's fucking great. And just like, you're just making something out of nothing. That's right. Always been your bread and butter from the days hosting at the Cellar to somebody saying something to you when you're on stage, when you're on a roll. You can put the bookmark in, address that, destroy that moment, get the audience still, like you don't, and then go back to your thing. Yeah. It's just like you're always spinning plates, which I like watching.
I appreciate that. But that's just from doing it. Like, you know how we did Ari? We do it all so much.
Sure.
Your brain just started working like that.
Yeah.
I mean, it's great on stage, but when you're around your family, it's annoying to them.
Well, let's watch Chris Rock here.
like doctors because they don't cure shit. They don't cure nothing. Same diseases been hanging out since I was a kid, man. What's the last shit a doctor cured? Polio. You know how long ago polio was? That's like the first season of Lucy. Shit, Fred had an afro with finger waves. Have you ever met anybody with polio? Anybody feel a little polio around you? No. That's right. They don't cure shit. Same disease been hanging out since I was a kid. AIDS, sickle cell, tuberculosis, cancer. Jerry's kid still limping around. That's right, man.
I'm gonna walk.
That's right. We got yeah. AIDS out there. You think they're gonna cure AIDS?
No.
No. They can't even cure athlete's foot. They ain't curing AIDS. Shit. They ain't never curing AIDS. They ain't never curing AIDS. Don't even think about that shit. They ain't curing that because ain't no money in the cure. The money's in the medicine. That's how you get paid on the comeback.
The comeback.
That's how a drug dealer makes his money on the comeback.
Got the Colorado Rockies symbol of the Rockies.
Drug dealers on the comeback. They ain't curing no AIDS. That's all it is. You think they gonna cure AIDS? That's still mad at all the money they lost on polio. Curing AIDS, shit. That's like Cadillac making a car that lasts for 50 years. And you know they can do it. But they ain't gonna do nothing that fucking dumb. Shit, they got metal on the space shuttle that could go around the moon and withstand temperatures of up to 20,000 degrees. You mean to tell me you don't think they can make an El Dorado with a fucking bumper don't fall off?
Classic!
They can, but they won't. So what they will do with AIDS is the same thing they do with everything else. They will figure out a way for you to live with it. Now they don't cure shit, they just patch it up. Get you to the next stop so they can get more of your money. That's right, they ain't gonna cure it. Hopefully, in our lifetime, that's right, you're gonna see somebody go, yo, man, you weren't at work yesterday, what's up? Hey, my AIDS is acting up. You know, when the weather gets like this, my AIDS just pop up. But I took some Robitussin, I'm fine now.
Robitussin still owes him a check, by the way. He kept them in the mainstream.
You know, when I watch this, you know, it just like, there is, you have to be smart to craft a good joke, right?
Yeah.
That's intelligence.
Yeah.
There's an intelligence that comes into, like, he's saying things on such a bird's eye macro view.
Right.
You've got to be extremely intelligent. Like, if you want to go on Bill Maher, if you want to go on Rogan, if you want to go on any of these shows, And you start going down the avenue of you got to know your shit.
You got to know your shit.
You got to know your shit. He knows his shit so well. It's done in such a fucking well-crafted way. The tags are as good as the fucking jokes.
Yes.
The tags are there to accentuate the jokes. The tags are as good, if not funnier than the fucking joke.
And he is all repetition with him. He keeps coming back with it. Bang, yeah. Bang, 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 bang. And it's the premise, setup, everything is just solid. But that's just from him being an intricate, like, because you got to cut the fat. Sometimes yeah. We overtalk, we waste words. Chrissy, one thing he taught me and told him, keep writing, and don't waste words in a joke. Like, get all those words out of there.
Yeah.
Let the joke show.
Get to it, yeah.
Yes. Yes. And then you add on more, but then cut the fat over that, and then it's all solid.
Yeah.
But, you know, it takes a lot.
It's like
he's a beast.
My favorite.
Yeah.
That is my, hands down, bar none, I have a lot of favorites. That is like the ring that I'll kiss.
Yeah.
That's the best.
It's annoying. Because he also uses a spilled orange juice in my goddamn Toyota Tercel and not wipe it up. He was a son of a bitch.
I remember one time I was on a date in New York City. We were killing time before we were going to the movie theater. And there was a Virgin Megastore on the Upper West Side. And I love documentaries, and so I picked up this documentary on the Underground Railroad.
Okay.
And Chris was there, and he saw me. You know, he's like, "Hey, what's up?" I'm like, "Hey, what's up, man?" He's like, "Hey, what'd you get?" I'm like, "No, I didn't want him to think like I'm like one That's of these self-hating like Asian like trying to be. I'm like, "Oh fuck!" What's up, man? How are you? Just like completely.
You hit it. Oh, no, yeah. He's just he's just a solid dude. I mean, it just, when you see this motherfucker working, I've seen Chrissy have some of the work. I've seen him get booed mercilessly.
Sure.
Like, some of the worst booings you ever, some crowds be like, eh. But he don't give a fuck about those club crowds like that. He ended up work that shit out.
Sure.
So when you see the finished product, you be like, what the hell was that?
Exactly.
But people in the clubs would be like this, well, he ain't that good. It's like, he'll tell the crowd, you ain't paid to see me. I just happen to stop here.
Sure, yeah.
You, how much you paid to get here? $8? That ain't a Chris Rock ticket. Right.
But even when you're saying they boo you, they're booing you because you're going to a place that people feel uncomfortable.
Yep.
But fortune favors the bold.
Yep.
He fucking got in there. He crossed the wires. He figured, oh, don't cut the blue wire this time. And then next time you cut the red one. And then he figured it out. And those are the bits. When you gamble, you go all in. You figure it the fuck out. That's when you get the fucking Emmys.
That's the best
stuff. That's when you get the Grammys. That's when you win hardware. That's when you win respect amongst your peers. Because even that bit, like, people can watch that and go, oh, it's fucking great. It's like, do you know what went into that?
Yeah.
Do you know fucking, you saw somebody give you a Rolls Royce.
Yeah.
That's what you saw.
Yeah.
The craftsmanship of that.
Yeah. You think it's just a regular conversation. Because it folds so effortlessly and everything's hitting. But nobody, people hear stuff like that and be like this. I say that all the time. No, you don't.
You don't.
You like try to say it.
Yeah.
But you don't.
But even if Chris, you know, if he comes in and he sees something inspiring and then he writes it down, he tries it up that night, he has the algorithm in his head that he was in the lab for 30, 40 years. So he knows how to construct the algorithm because he put all the work in the lab in early on. So nowadays, in his 50s, he can go, oh, I know how to do that now.
Yeah.
Now I know how to put that together.
Yeah.
It still takes time.
That's why it's great.
Melody, but
it's great that we've spent all those hours in the cellar and the strip and all these clubs because we buried ourselves in it.
Yeah.
And that's how I wanted to do it. I was like, I'm going to bury myself in comedy.
Yeah.
When I started this shit, I said, I'm not going to be on the surface. I'm going all in.
All of it,
I want to take all the hits. I want to have the hell gigs. I want to know how to get in and out of situations on stage.
We were in every night because when you passed the cellar at that time, again, like you said, there were only 12 spots, and she had this young crew of comics, and we were there every night. New Year's, Christmas. Yep. It didn't matter.
All
I was there all the time.
Food from home for Thanksgiving now.
Unbelievable. Well, I'm glad to have shared that experience with you, buddy. I love you.
I love you.
I really do. All right. This is the last one. We're always on the hook because we don't just talk about comics we like or judge them because sometimes you see clips where you're like, I appreciate that, but I still, you know, here's my issue with that.
Okay.
But this is always one of us. So let's see what we got here. Oh, thank God. Okay.
What?
It's a clip of you. Woo!
Oh,
I don't
want to
watch a clip of me. The last clip I watched of me, it was so fucking bad. It ruined my day.
I'm nervous now. Is this a clip from me from like Citizens app?
This is okay. It's live at Gotham. So this is fairly new. It's
okay. Well,
mixtape comedy.
Maybe.
Show, let's see.
Yeah. Okay.
Here we go. A little Sherrod Small.
Look how fat I was. Asian dude, you got any answers? Look at me. What's your name, man? Arthur. That's the most un-Asian name. All right. That's worse than like you saying your name was like Leroy. Okay. Leroy Chang. Who's his girlfriend? Who's this girl with you? Friend, huh? A friend? What, you waiting for the roofie to kick in? Thank you, college kids.
There you go.
All the college kids woke up. What? Roofies? You got to get married someday. Don't you know that, Arthur? Yeah, got to get married. If you're a man, you got to get married. Because women want to get married. And they have the vagina. Checkmate. I knew the Asian kid would laugh on checkmate. The vagina! That's what it comes down to, but let's stop playing games. The vagina is the strongest thing in the universe. Girls, don't clap. I don't need you to rub it in my face. Wait, I'm sorry. Rub it in my face.
There it go.
I remember that line.
Fat bastard.
Don't remember. Well, how long ago was that?
I don't.
Because you're CrossFit and you're.
Yeah, that's.
You're fit now.
That was, I don't know how long that was. 7 years, maybe?
7 years ago? Okay, yeah.
It might have been more than that.
Yeah.
I'm trying to figure out the shirt. I'm not going to tell what year it is in my life by what shirt I got on. Yeah. But I was fat.
Well, You look great.
Thank you. I got big over that break, too. When I taped, I got into the show Harlem on Amazon Prime, mm-hmm. first season of Harlem. And then we was doing playbacks. I was like, why is Craig Robinson doing my part? I was like, oh, shit, that's me. Oh, damn. Oh, shit. That camera is a son of a bitch.
Now you're eating the Pizza Hut, watching Craig doing the Pizza Hut, and you're like.
Yeah. And the Gain commercial.
Yeah.
Gain? Like, wait, Craig's?
That dude is the best.
He's so fun. I love him. Love him. Love his brother Chris. Talented musicians, too.
We were hanging out at the Cellar Christmas party.
Yeah.
He's like, come with me. I go, okay, yeah. We go to Blue Note.
Yeah.
Listen to two or three songs. And as gifted as he is, he knows everything there is to know about jazz.
Yeah.
He was giving me like a master class in terms of who these people were on stage, why he appreciates them, who they were influenced by. I was like, God damn.
No, he knows this music. Really, him and his brother Chris. Chris is a great musician as well. But yeah, they know, you know, good friends with Robert Glasper and all the guys at the Blue Note come through there.
Very nice. Well, I got to tell you, this is one of my favorites because I always love seeing you. I hate seeing you after midnight at the Cellar because I'm like, well, I guess I'm going to my flight drunk. But so many times at the Cellar, I think I'm out of there. And then I see you. I'm like, well, I got to fucking hang.
We got to hang a little.
Yeah. I love you. I'm excited to do the show with you here at Zanie's. And I hope you come down to Nashville a lot more, buddy.
Oh, yes. Yeah. I will. I'm the new sheriff.
Well, how do they keep up with you, buddy?
Who? Oh, people in
Socials.
Yeah, social media. It's Sherrod Small. At Sherrod Small on Instagram. Sherrod _small on Twitter.
Yeah.
And then Sherrod on Facebook. And then a TikTok.
Just look for this face and type in
Sherrod Small. Yeah.
Yeah, you'll see it.
Yeah. Okay. And well, check out my new shows, though. Harlem on Amazon Prime. Girls Five Ever, second season on Peacock.
Congrats.
And everything's going to be on White on Showtime.
There we go. Look at this. The IMDb page blowing up. Well, we got to thank our sponsor, and we got to go right here. New script. Here we go. Camp Lejeune. Justice Act 2022. For many years between 1953 to 1987, Marines, their family members, and infant children were exposed to contaminated drinking water at Camp Lejeune, including all satellite camps. Many were sickened, died unnecessarily because of the groundwater contaminated. If you or your loved one lived or served at Camp Lejeune, call us now for information and legal help. You may be eligible for a significant financial compensation. Call the Law Office of Environmental Litigation Group at 888-660-2492. Again, 888-660-2492. Thank you very much. Another episode in the books from Zanie's Comedy Pinata. My buddy.
Steve-O.
Sherrod Small.
My name.
We're getting some hot chicken. All right. Thank you, Taylor.